Friends, if you would, if you could now begin to finish the sentence you are speaking, I would like to call us to order for our afternoon session. I'm pleased to have this opportunity to serve you as a presiding officer for these couple of hours this afternoon. I'm assuming you want to go to work. Are you ready to go to work? All right, we have a lot to do, so I'm glad you're ready to work. I'll try to help you do that as best I can. I'd like to begin with a few words from Philippians. This is one of my favorite passages. I think it's one that perhaps has already been shared this week. And it's the introduction to this beautiful hymn we have from the early church, where Paul is writing, "Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort in love, any sharing in the Spirit, any sympathy, complete my joy." Ooh, I love that part. "Complete my joy by thinking the same way, having the same love, being united and agreeing with each other. Don't do anything for selfish purposes, but with humility think of others as better than yourselves. Instead of each person watching out for their own good, watch out for what is better for others." Good words for us this afternoon and as we continue our work. Would you pray with me? Holy God, we have come from a time of refreshment and lunch, and now we are ready to begin to do your work once again. And we so desperately want it to be work that will complete your joy, O Lord. Complete your joy. And so we pray in these moments that our first impulse, our first thought as we speak or as we discern would be what is good for the other person and good for your church. And so we pray this afternoon that you would work through us, for there's much work to be done, but that you would work through us to fulfill your purposes, your intentions. In the name of the Christ we pray, amen. I'm pleased to inform you, as you probably can already see, that Bishop Hope Morgan Ward and Bishop Warner Brown have agreed to assist me as that is needed this afternoon. And I want to thank them now, lest I forget. And just a couple of reminders of where we're at as I've observed our work the last couple of days. It appears to me that you really want to debate the items and not be consumed with an inordinate number of points of order or inquiries for information. I hope I'm right about that. Because if I am right about that, then you can help me, and you can help one another by being sensitive to trying to stay focused on speeches for and against the items that are before us and not consuming all of our time with inquiries. At the same time, I would say if at any point I am misleading you or not representing the will of the body, I do hope you will call that to my attention by using our queuing system. Just a further reminder, that we approved a change in our rules this morning so that as we continue our work this afternoon, we'll be under the rule of two speeches for and against, and we would go automatically at that point to voting on item, and that we've limited our speeches as well to 2 minutes each. We do have an announcement about the crosses that are on your table. I'm going to ask our secretary to share that with you.
The peace crosses on your table are for this afternoon's presentation by the Korea Peace Committee. Please leave them on the table until after the presentation. Thank you.
We have two brief orders of the day, and then we're going to turn to our calendar items. First, I would like to call on Bill Lawrence, who is going to lead us in recognizing those Judicial Council members that will be retiring. Bill, if you would come.
Thank you, Bishop. Delegates and friends of the General Conference, I have the honor of serving as President of the Judicial Council for the current quadrennium, and I have the privilege of greeting you on behalf of the newest, the smallest, and the least noticed constitutional body of our church. At least the Judicial Council is the least noticed until you or some other entity in United Methodism brings a matter to the Judicial Council, which can then create conversation about why the cause was sent to the Judicial Council, or why indeed the Council exists at all. For nearly two centuries of the denominational history that led to what we now call the United Methodist Church, the Judicial Council did not exist. Francis Asbury, who died exactly 200 years ago at the 1816 General Conference, would never have imagined there was a need for a constitutional judiciary. He barely understood why there was a need for a constitution when it was established in 1808. For most of the history of Methodism as we know it, the General Conference wrote church laws, and the bishops decided whether they approved of the church's laws. Then, early in the 20th century, as separated parts of Methodism began to talk about reuniting, the idea of having a constitutionally established judiciary became an important element in the discussions. When reunion finally happened in 1939, a judicial council was a cornerstone of the Constitution, and so it remains to this day. The persons on the platform have served in the current quadrennium or will serve in the coming quadrennium as the Judicial Council of the United Methodist Church. It is not the role of the Council to determine whether the legislative actions of the General Conference or the procedural actions of others in the denomination are pleasant procedurally or popular programmatically. It is the role of the Judicial Council simply to determine whether such actions are in accord with the Constitution and with the laws of the church in the discipline. That is who the Judicial Council is. I want to introduce those individuals who, like me, have done that work and are now concluding our terms of service on the Judicial Council. Reverend Kathy Austin Molly, a clergy member of the Minnesota Annual Conference. Dr. Sandra Lutz, a layperson from Ohio. And Dr. Belton Joyner, a clergy member of the North Carolina Annual Conference. Like you, I deeply appreciate their work. And now I have the honor of introducing to you the person who will be the next president of the Judicial Council. He will then introduce the persons who, in new or continuing terms, will be the officers and members of the Judicial Council for the coming quadrennium. Please welcome President-elect Oswald Tway.
Good afternoon. And also Tua from the Liberia Annual Conference, who has been elected President of the Judicial Council for this quadrennium. I would now like to introduce the members of the Judicial Council for the 2016-2020 quadrennium. Reverend Dennis Blackwell from New Jersey. Ms. Beth Kippen from New York, Lee from New York. Mr. Ruben Reeves, Lee from the Philippines. Reverend Kabamba Kiboko. Kabamba Kiboko from. Yes. Ms. Lucia Gulli from Mozambique. Reverend Owen Helgesen from Norway. Reverend Luan Vutran from California. Unfortunately, one of the members was unable to be here today. We thank you for the confidence you post in us, and with God being our helper, we pledge to do our utmost in this ministry. Thank you.
We want to congratulate Oswald Tway as he assumes the presidency of the Judicial Council, and I would invite you to join with me in just a word of prayer for this body. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we lift up these persons that you have called forth to serve as our judicial council in this next quadrennium. And we pray that you would gift them mightily with your wisdom and courage and compassion for your people. May they be an instrument of your grace on behalf of this church, as we seek to fulfill our mission of making disciples of Jesus for the transformation of the world. In the name of the Christ we pray, amen. All right, we're going to move to some calendar items, but I have a inquiry or point of order. On microphone number 4, Samuel Rayapa, I believe. If you would go to microphone number 4. Microphone 4, no, please.
Sam Royapa, clergy, Wisconsin Annual Conference. Bishop, I am seeking information for the following questions. What is the sense of where we are in terms of completing our work around petitions? How many petitions have been processed by the plenary? How many petitions are yet to be processed by the plenary in the next 1.5 days?
The question is appropriate, and I'll turn to our secretary and our secretarial staff.
We need a little time to gather that, but we'd be happy to present it.
All right, I've been informed that we'll need just a little bit of time to gather that information so that it's accurate, and I'll interrupt our proceedings as soon as we have it so that we can answer your question. It's a very important question, and my sense is that that knowledge might, in fact, help guide our work this afternoon and through the remainder of our time. So thank you very much. I'm going to call next for the next calendar item, and Morris Mathis and Beth Ann Cook are presenters.
Good afternoon, saints.
That was lousy response. Yeah. Yeah, come on, let's do this that again. Try that again.
Good afternoon, saints.
There we go, that's better. Okay, go ahead.
Good afternoon, sinners.
Yeah, yeah. See, we know who we are.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. So I guess we're all here, so let's get started. I'm blessed to have served as the chair of Church and Society 2, and it is a joy to be standing before you today.
We're glad you're standing before us as well. Thank you.
And if I could take a moment of privilege, I do want to express appreciation to so many of you for your expressions of care and concern since I passed out this past Friday evening, bringing a whole new meaning in our life together to bringing something to the floor. I am well, and I am grateful to have worked with the faithful followers of Jesus who served on our committee, and to have worked with our incredible leadership team, George Wilson, Vice Chair, Salvador Milanes, Secretary, and the 4 subcommittee chairs, Bayou Watete, Latrell Easterling, T.R. Chatton, and Brad Lauervik. We have 4 petitions for you today. The first can be found on page 2322, 2322 of your DCA, 2322, and is calendar item 491. 491. In your ADCA, it is on page 325 and petition number 60837. The title is Withdraw from Religious Coalition for Reproductive Choice. It was adopted by the committee by a vote of 44 to 25, and rationale for that support will be presented by committee member Beth Ann Cook.
Excuse me. All right. This is properly before us, and we will have speeches for and against. However, there's first a...
I think I'm supposed to present the committee's rationale.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Thank you, Bishop. I am grateful for an opportunity to present this petition, which originated in my annual conference, Indiana Annual Conference. Your Church and Society B legislative group believes the time has come to withdraw from this DC-based political lobbying group called the Religious Coalition for Reproductive Choice. Our United Methodist Church has a carefully nuanced official position on the difficult issue of abortion. It is not as strongly pro-life as some of us would like, nor as clearly pro-choice as others would like. This group is neither nuanced nor moderate. They oppose any legal restriction on abortion at any time in pregnancy. During our debate, two issues came up in particular. First is the issue of gender selection abortions, a practice which has resulted in millions of missing girls around the world. Our committee chair has a daughter from a country that casts off girls and is horrified at the thought of associating ourselves with any organization that will not denounce this practice as the United Methodist Church denounces it. And as a feminist, I am deeply offended by that as well. Another committee member who served on the General Board of Church and Society attended an RCRC board meeting at their behest. He came away convinced that our church should not in any way affiliate with RCRC. He first heard RCRC advocate in that meeting that they would hold up abortion when the child can survive outside the mother's womb, not just at 7 months or 8 months, but right up to the moment that the baby takes its first breath. They do all of this while using the name of the United Methodist Church on their publications. Given this information, I ask you, does the Religious Coalition for Reproductive Choice really speak for you and for our church? On behalf of both the Indiana Annual Conferences and the Church and Society B Legislative Group, I urge you to support this petition to withdraw from RCRC.
Thank you, Beth Ann. I have a point of order or a parliamentary inquiry request for information, and microphone four, Doug Dameron. Recognize you, please.
Doug Dameron, West Ohio Conference. I'm just wondering, would this legislation be referred to the commission that's going to be formed after this general conference? Thank you.
My understanding is that if it's coming today, it has already been vetted and is properly before us. Thank you. There is a motion to table, postpone, or refer. Microphone four, Gail Shearman.
Thank you, Bishop. Gail Shearman, California-Nevada Conference layperson. I want to make a motion to refer.
It's in order.
Okay, because sections of our social principles, such as population, responsible parenthood, rights of children, rights of women, and support rights of all persons to have access to a wide range of reproductive health services, And because we already
I'm going to interrupt you for just a moment. My mistake. I need to be sure we have a second for it, because you started. There is a second. You start into your speech, so please continue.
So my motion is that we refer this matter to the General Conference Council on Finance and Administration, in keeping with paragraph 806.10, where they already have the authority to be in dialogue around the church opposing late-term abortion, and that it shall have the right to stop any expenditures.
All right. This is a motion to refer. It is debatable, and we've had a speech for it. Is there? We're on the motion to refer, so I'm going to clear the queue. I know many of you are wanting to speak on this. I can tell that by the screen, but we're going to clear it so we can stay very focused on what's before us. We're just on the motion to refer. Is there anyone else that would care to speak for or against the motion to refer? I'll give you a moment to enter.
At the end, I would like to speak on behalf of the committee against.
That's an order. She can speak. All right. I have some speeches against. I'm going to call first on Vernon Scott, microphone 4.
Thank you, Bishop. What this annual conference has done so far, better than ever before, is to refer. As Marquise Hobbs said yesterday, it's time for us to stand up, show some courage, and make a decision. We need to defeat this motion to refer and let it stand on its merits. That's why we're here. Show some courage, folks. Follow what God has told you in your hearts to do. Thank you.
All right. I want to keep our discussion balanced, so I'm looking for a speech in favor of referral. I don't see any right now, so I'll take the next speech against. Rudolph Marab, I believe it is, microphone 6.
Thank you, Bishop. Rudolph Marab. I think I go along with the previous speaker. It's about time we as Christians witness for Jesus Christ. Let's not delay the issue, and therefore I ask you to vote down the referral.
All right. There's another speech against. I'm still looking for a speech for. Just a reminder of our rules. We need 2 and 2. I have 1 speech for and 2 against. We can continue until I have the balance. Oh, all right. I'm trying to keep it balanced here. I don't see 1 for, and I think we've had our 2 speeches against. I think you're ready to deal with this, from what I can tell. If you would get your voting devices. If you get them handy, I'll remind you what's before us. This is a motion to refer the item.
Yes.
If you would,
yes,
Beth, you can speak, yes.
On behalf of the committee, I would urge you not to refer this. It is my understanding that our support is the use of our name and not really financial support, which I believe would mean it would not really need to go to GCF&A. I would also echo what some previous speakers have said about the fact that it has been a while that we've been talking about this. Over 12 years ago, Indiana first sent the petition to withdraw from RCRC. 8 years ago at General Conference, the body narrowly decided to remain part of this group in the hopes that being at the table in dialogue would help moderate RCRC's stance. This has not happened. In Tampa, the committee voted decisively to withdraw from RCRC, but time ran out before the plenary could discuss it. I would urge you not to refer this and to make a decision on it at this time. Thank you.
All right, if you would, we're going, the motion before us is to refer. If you get your voting devices handy, if you would vote for referral, that would be a yes vote. You'd vote yes. For not referring would be no. You can vote now. You have voted not to refer, so the item is before us. We're going to clear the queue once again. So the motion, the original motion is before us, and we can have speeches for and against. I have a speech against Rebecca Garrett, I believe. Or no, excuse me. I'm sorry. My glasses, my trifocals are got straight. Mixed up. Rebecca Garrell, microphone 6, please. This is a speech against.
That's correct, Bishop. Thank you. Rebecca Garrell, clergy, New England Annual Conference of the United States. I want to share some information with you about the Religious Coalition for Reproductive Choice, or RCRC. Because I do not think that everyone has accurate information about this coalition. It is a national, that is to the United States, community of religious and spiritual people, denominations, and organizations from all faith traditions, working together for ethical and responsible policies, laws, and resources addressing reproductive health and reproductive health care access. The UMC was a founding member of this coalition, and this gives us an opportunity to be in conversation with a wide range of people. In her introduction, we heard that the UMC's position on abortion is carefully nuanced, and indeed it is. That is our official denominational position on abortion. RCRC does not speak for the United Methodist Church, but we speak to it. In doing so, we demonstrate how we can work in coalitions within and beyond the United States for the health of women and children everywhere. We also provide training for clergy and laity to be in ministry with people who have experienced or considered abortion. I urge you to vote no on this resolution. Thank you.
I'm going to call next on Darcy Rubin King. This is a speech for. Microphone 4, please.
Darcy Rubin King, Iowa Annual Conference, laity. I move to support this motion to remove us from RCRC. I, for one, am pro-life and really would dislike the fact that my apportionment dollars supports this. I see that abortion, in my opinion, is murder, and that I don't want the name of my church or my finances going to push this agenda. I would ask that you would vote to take us out of RCRC. Thank you.
All right. Excuse me. Thank you. Ready for a speech against. I'm going to call on Courtney Fowler at microphone number 2. Just a moment. I'm going to need to interrupt you because we have a point of order or a parliamentary inquiry. Sarah Swenson, microphone 5, please.
Hello, this is Sarah Swenson from Minnesota.
Sarah, identify what you want, a point of order or a parliamentary inquiry, or do you need some information?
It's a question for information.
All right.
I feel like we just had two very different, we heard two different things about whether or not there are financial implications to our involvement in RCRC. The presenter had said that this didn't have any financial implications, and the last speaker just said apportionment dollars are going to RC. So this seems like I would like some more actual statistics from whoever has them.
I'm going to turn to the committee chair for an answer to that.
That would be you.
I don't know.
Very helpful. I don't think we know right now. I'm going to call next on Elka Lyle, another, I hope I pronounced that correctly, another point of order, parliamentary inquiry information. Microphone 3, please.
Thank you, Bishop. Elka Lyle, Northern Illinois Conference clergy. Bishop, this...
Can you identify if it's a question for information, point of order, or parliamentary inquiry?
It's information.
Okay, you're requesting information. All
I'm
right.
requesting information. It is a sensitive issue, Bishop. We are talking about a health of a woman. We are talking about an organization that we have been part of. In fact, we are founding members of it for years. And so I would like to ask if it is possible for us to get somebody from the Board of Church and Society to come and explain to us why we became part of this organization in this coalition in the first place.
All right, I think you're asking if the body would allow a person who's not seated, who is a member of, or who could represent Church of Society would speak. I'm going to let the House determine that.
Thank you, Bishop.
All right, thank you. I'm going to have you use your voting devices just so we're very, very clear. If you would allow the speaker, it'll be yes. If no, if you would prefer not to, it would be no. You ready? Vote now. All right, you've indicated that you would prefer to have some information from Board of Church and Society. Is there somebody prepared to speak? Elka, did you have someone in mind, or were you just hopeful? All right. Microphone 4, please, and please identify yourself. Thank you very much.
Hi, Susan Burton, General Board of Church and Society, Director of Women's and Children's Advocacy and Organizing. I'm here speaking on behalf of our General Secretary, Reverend Dr. Susan Henry Crow. I want to clarify that neither GBCS nor United Methodist Women spend any money at all to be part of this coalition.
All right, thank you very much. We're back on the motion, and I was about to call, I believe, on Courtney Fowler when we had the point of order. We have another point of order, however. I'm gonna need to interrupt to take care of that. Rebecca Garrell, microphone 6, please. And as you come, please be prepared to indicate if it's a point of order or parliamentary inquiry or if you're requesting information.
Bishop, I was going to ask for someone from Church and Society. I withdraw.
All right. Thank you very much. Then we are ready for Courtney. This would be a speech against. Microphone 2, please.
Courtney. Courtney Fowler, Great Plains Conference. I wish to speak against this petition. As a woman of faith, it deeply saddens me that every 2 minutes, some woman somewhere in the world dies in childbirth. The consequences from a woman's inability to access reproductive health care is literally life-threatening. As a maternal health advocate, I too want to reduce the number of abortions as well. I want healthy babies to be born. As a United Methodist maternal health advocate, I work very hard on this issue, but we cannot do the work alone. It takes all of our faith voices working together. This does not in any way affect our United Methodist position on abortion. It remains the same. But if we really want to reduce abortions, let's be part of faith-based efforts to reduce abortion, not reduce a woman's access to reproductive health care. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a couple of requests for point of order or parliamentary inquiry or information. First, back to Elka Lyle at microphone 3, please. And again, it's very helpful to the chair and I think to the body to know exactly what you're asking for as you come.
Bishop Elka Lyle, clergy, Northern Illinois. It's still a point of information. My original question to Board of Church and Society was, why was it important for us to become part of the coalition? So if we can invite somebody from Board of Church and Society again to share with us that information and then why it was important to be part of that coalition for us as a faith organization.
All right, I think you're correct that your specific question probably was not answered, and the House has indicated they were open to information, so please go ahead. Microphone 4, please.
Susan Burton, General Board of Church and Society again. I apologize for not answering specifically. The Coalition for the Reproductive Coalition, RCRC, Religious Coalition for Reproductive Choice, was founded because there were local pastors, some of whom were United Methodist, who were dealing with women in their congregations who were dying because they were trying to give themselves abortions. There were advocates speaking out for women and believing that women needed to have access to reproductive health care provided by physicians. The United Methodist Church, specifically the General Board of Church and Society and United Methodist Women, have maintained our membership in this coalition because we believe it's important to give voice to a theologically diverse group. We are the only group who spans a very theological diverse group. There are Jewish groups that believe theologically that life begins at first breath. When we are in conversation with those groups, we talk about, as United Methodist, some of the things that we think is important, like consent for young people, like a 20-week ban. We advocate for the United Methodist position, and we therefore think that this interfaith position is richer because of our participation.
All right, thank you. Let me tell you where we are in our process. We've had one speech for and two speeches against. I can take one more speech for, and I'm going to call on Catherine Roars at microphone 4 for a speech for, in favor.
Thank you, Bishop. My name is Kathy Roars. I'm a layperson from West Ohio. In 2012, 2008, and 2004, I have sat as a delegate to General Conference and mourned about this issue. I specifically remember people in the past saying that we need to stay at the table in RCRC because our voice matters. But nothing has changed. Our social principles truly have a moderate voice about abortion. We denounce abortion as a means of birth control, and we do not affirm or agree with partial birth abortion. We encourage adoption as an alternative to abortion and affirm the rights of parents to be involved in decisions of their minors. But RCRC refuses to talk about unborn children as just that. They condemn any attempts to limit abortions, even partial birth abortions. They refuse to condemn abortion as a form of birth control or gender selection. They affirm abortion in any way. Whatever you may hear, RCRC is not a moderate organization. I don't speak for all young women who are United Methodists. But as a mother of two, I speak for those who have not been surrounded by the church's support to cheer them on to life. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bishop, may I speak on behalf of the committee? Thank you.
Just to be very clear where we're at, we've had two speeches for now and two speeches against, and under our rules that you have affirmed, we will be moving to vote on this matter following a final statement from the committee.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, as you make your decision on this issue, it's important to remember that RCRC is not a healthcare provider. It is a lobbying group, and it's not the only lobbying group. It is also an organization that is one means of advocating for women's health care.
Beth, your vote. I'm going to interrupt you because there are points of order, and okay. I want to be sure we are in order.
Sure.
Dorothea Bentz, microphone 6, please.
Thank you, Bishop. It's Dorothy Bentz, actually.
Yes, I see that. I'm sorry.
That's all right. Point of information. Could we get some information on what RC actually advocates?
It's a
there's wonderful
inquiry for information.
The information that I am sharing has come from their own website, so I would say that's the best location. I know not everyone has the ability to access this immediately.
Yeah, since there was not it was a general inquiry about information, I'm assuming that the information that you're sharing is the information. Yeah. All right, I have another inquiry. Mihail Stefanov, point of order, our parliamentary inquiry information, microphone 3, please.
Mihail Stefanov, Bulgaria, Romania, Provisional Annual Conference, and this is a point of information in order to understand the process.
Sure.
I'm asking why does the presenter of the motion has the last speech twice? Because according to my understanding, the first last speech that she gave was after a motion to refer made by somebody else. So the first time she wasn't supposed to have the right for the last speech because we had already two speeches against. I hope you understand what I mean.
If I wasn't here, I'd come and give you a big hug. You are correct. And so I'm going to ask that Beth stand down. Thank you very much. And thank you for helping me and this body. This is actually something I knew and I forgot, so I appreciate it very much. We are ready to vote. We've had the speeches for and against. If you would pick up your devices, your voting devices. If you are in favor of the petition, you'll vote yes. If not, vote no. You can vote now. All right, you have voted in favor of the petition. We're ready to move, I think, to the next item, and if I can find my list here. Well, I'll tell you what, let's just rely on Morris. He knows where we are. Okay, Morris. Oh, excuse me, I'm going to interrupt you. We have a couple of other inquiries. Michael Childs, microphone 3. And as you come again, it would be very helpful if you identify if it's a point of order or a parliamentary inquiry or information being requested. Microphone 3, please.
Bishop, I rise for a point of order.
Yes.
Under Section 8 of the Plan of Organization, I challenge the action of this General Conference in adopting the Howard motion with respect to the Council of Bishops report delivered on Wednesday, May 18th. The establishment of an interim commission has financial implications, and under Section 8A, and I quote, any action proposed to General Conference plenary to establish an interim commission shall be referred to GCFA, the connectional table, their executive committees, or the expenditure review group for a report and recommendation before final action. Furthermore, under Section 8C, and I quote, any proposal falling under the provision of this section shall be referred at least 72 hours prior to the scheduled adjournment of General Conference. Now, the Howard motion was not referred as required and was made less than 72 hours prior to the scheduled adjournment of General Conference. The Howard motion and our adoption of it was a violation of our standing rules of Section 8 of the Plan of Organization. So I asked the chair to rule that our adoption of the Howard motion was out of order and the action is null and void. Thank you.
Thank you. You're going to give me just a minute to consult here. Thank you. All right, thank you for your patience. I wanted to be absolutely clear that the information that I thought I knew was in fact accurate. I would remind the body that GCFA extended the deadline for yesterday so that that matter and other matters with financial implications could in fact be considered. GCFA and the CT have considered that. They do have this incorporated into the budget recommendation that they'll bring. So, sir, I'm going to rule your inquiry out of order.
I appeal your ruling to the body because they did not extend the date of adjournment of annual conference. It violates the rules, and I appeal to this body.
All right. So let me try to sort this out with you. I want to be very clear where we're at, and then if the body feels that they want to give some other direction, they can do that. The deadline for the submission of financial matters to GCFA was in fact extended to all matters. If we were to change that, it would impact all matters that were referred for financial if we would rule that that deadline was null and void. And so I believe this is in order.
But it also says before the adjournment of annual conference, 72 hours, that was not changed. It violates the rules, and I appeal to this body.
Sir, I think you've made your point. I'm going to ask you to be seated. Thank you. I have a number of points of order and parliamentary inquiry coming up now. So I'm going to turn to James Colwart and microphone 5, point of order, parliamentary inquiry, or information. Please identify what you have in mind. Microphone 5.
The former speaker addressed my concerns.
All right. Next, Don Underwood, microphone 5 as well. Point of inquiry or parliamentary inquiry. Point of order, excuse me, or parliamentary inquiry.
Don Underwood, North Texas clergy. Bishop, I'm not absolutely sure about this, but the Howard statement was in response to the request from the Council of Bishops to affirm the statement that they made. And I think I'm right about this, that the Council of Bishops acted autonomously on this. The Council of Bishops has access to its own funding, including funding for an interim general conference if it decided to call one. I think I'm right about this. It would not require the action of this conference. Thank you.
Thank you. That's helpful, Don. excuse me. Next, Sergey Kim, microphone 2, please.
Sergey Kim, Central Russia. Dear Bishop, I'm not very sure that our voting machines are working correctly.
I'm sorry, just a moment. I am not hearing you, and I need to hear you. So, all right. If your voting machine is not working, please, could a page assist? Yes, right there. We'll assist you with...
I'm just not very sure whether they are working correctly. Because one time before, during one of the votes, we did receive a message that our vote was received. However, now we are not seeing the same message. The message received is not showing up, so we're not sure if our votes have reached the system. We're not quite clear. So we really would like to act to get some help on this, to get some assistance.
Yes, thank you. We're checking here to make sure that that we can get you the information you need. Any information about the I'm trying to address the inquiry about the voting machines. Your machine should said send. It should indicate that your vote has been recorded, but then we clear those. So hopefully, if you still think it's not working, please consult a page and we'll get you a new device. All right, back to those people who are making inquiries about points of order, our parliamentary inquiry of Fred Brewington, microphone 6, please.
Bishop, I was in the previous queue. There's no need for me to speak at this time.
All right, thank you very much. We'll go next to Joe, getting ahead of myself. Cynthia Moore, is it Koike? Kokoi. Microphone 6, please.
Cynthia Moore, Kokoi, clergy of Baltimore Washington Conference. Bishop, I had cleared myself from the queue because you addressed the issue.
All right. Joe Kilpatrick, senior, please. Microphone 6.
Just trying to read what it says. It implies, seems to imply in these in Rule 8 that the action of the General Counsel on Finance and Administration is necessary to complete the work. I'm not sure that it indicates it has to occur before we vote. Which seems to be the issue, but the they do have considerable authority here so far as the expenditure, estimated budgets, and a statement explaining how the creation of the proposed board will affect budgets or budgets for existing boards. It does appear that there are some additional steps necessary. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Would the House permit me to bring some additional information to you? I've been a little reluctant to do this because these financial matters are coming to us a bit later, but I think I might be able to help address some of the concerns if you would allow me to call upon the chair of GCFA to make a brief report. If you would be open to that, would you please raise a hand so I'm confident about that. All right, thank you very much. If you're opposed, same sign. Well, the body's just given me permission to ask Bishop Coiner to provide some information. But I'll hear you. I'll hear you. Go ahead. Microphone 11, please. Or microphone 1, excuse me. There are no 11s.
John Martin, Upper New York clergy. Bishop, this point of order pertains to rule number 3, which talks about a delegate appealing the ruling of the presiding chair. It says that's not debatable, and that the person appealing the ruling, as well as the chair, have the opportunity to speak to it, but then we must vote on that. And I believe we've moved beyond that, but I think we're breaking our own rules right now.
Thank you very much. The reason we've moved beyond it is I believe we are within the rules. I'm going to call on Bishop Coiner, please.
I hope this information will be helpful to you. The rules do state that financial implication items which would affect the budget have to be brought in 72 hours before we bring the end of annual general conference. GCFA did announce, and perhaps you all should have voted on that as a rule change, that we were willing to extend that another day because you were moving so slowly on some of your items. Nonetheless, the particular item you're referring to, the adoption, you adopted what the bishops brought you. The only financial implication there that would normally apply would be the creation of that commission that was listed. And we have met as GCFA and CTA and found a way to fund that outside the budget. So I don't believe it matters the timing on that. We're not bringing that to you as a part of the budget proposal tomorrow at all. We will be reporting to you on how we plan to fund that. A called general conference is within the purview of the Council of Bishops at any time, and it's not something you add to the budget or deal with in budget discussions. We will bring you tomorrow a report on the ways we see that cost might be covered in the future if there is such an event called. So I apologize if our extending the time for you to have a budget request in has caused difficulty, but I do believe in this case, the commission that you voted that could be developed and appointed by the Council of Bishops is not something that will be related to the budget, and we'll be sharing that information with you tomorrow in more detail.
Thank you, Bishop Coiner. I have another inquiry, Kenitha Bingham-Tai, from microphone 1, please.
Kenitha Bingham-Tai, West Michigan, and thank you, Bishop. I do believe that Bishop Coiner has provided clarity. Thank you.
Thank you. Lonnie Chaffin, or Chaffin, excuse me, for microphone 3.
Thank you, Bishop. Lonnie Chaffin, Northern Illinois Conference. I remind the body that during the Committee on Agenda presentation, there was a motion, there was a report that the deadline for budget matters was extended, and that was approved by this general conference by some 90%. While it wasn't a motion to suspend the rules specifically, it did in effect suspend the rules, and by action of this body, we extended that deadline to a new date. So I think I wanted to support the chair in ruling that this is not a point of order, or wanted to support the chair in the appeal of the chair.
Thank you very much. I apologize if I was rude. I was aware of these actions that are taken. That's why I thought we were in order. But perhaps I could have been more sensitive and made sure this information was available to you much earlier in this discussion. So I think we are ready to move on. And so I would clear the queue and call on the chairperson. There we go, Church and Society. Thank you.
Our next petition can be found on page 2322 of your DCAs. 2322. is item number 492. 492. In your ADCA, it's on page 356, 356. And it's petition number 60838. 60838. And the title simply is deletion. This petition relates to the one on which we acted a few moments ago. It simply calls for deleting resolution 3204, support for the Religious Coalition for Reproductive Choice. It was adopted by the committee by a vote of 47-20.
All right, item 492. Our calendar item 492 is properly before us, and I want to give you an opportunity to indicate on the queue if you would like to speak for or against. I do not see anyone queuing up, but I'll give you just another few seconds. All right, it appears you may be ready to act on this. If you would take your voting devices in hand. If you are supportive of this item, you'll vote yes. If not, no, you can vote now. All right, you have voted in favor of that item. We'll continue.
Petition, I'm sorry, on your DCAs, page 2207, 2207, item number 388, 388. In your ADCAs, page 365, 365, petition number 60122. The title, Opposition to White Privilege in the U.S. It was adopted by a vote of 47-16 and will be presented by T.R. Chatton, subcommittee chair.
At General Conference 2000, we first adopted a resolution opposing white privilege. Sadly, in recent years, we've been reminded ever more powerfully of the systemic nature of white privilege and racism. The legislation before us today is an updated resolution on opposing white privilege. The committee, as has been said, approved with one amendment adding the word predominantly in line 6, approved 47-16. The remainder of the changes of the resolution consist in updating the statistics around the racial disparities in the United States. For example, one in 2008, one in four African American men were likely to be imprisoned in their lifetime. This updated resolution with current statistics now point out that one in three African American men are likely to be imprisoned in their lifetime. Other statistics are added that certainly show that we are going not in the direction that we would hope to be going. Thus, it is ever more imperative for the church to wrestle with this reality and our ongoing commitment to dismantle racism both in our church and in our community. Our legislative committee moves adoption of this petition.
All right, it's properly before us. I want to see if there are any speeches for or against. I'll give you a moment to enter your request in the queue. All right, I don't see anybody seeking the floor, so I think maybe we're ready, and I don't think it's necessary to go back to the chair since we've just heard the speech. I think you're ready. If you would get your voting devices handy. If you are in favor, you'll vote yes. If not, vote no. You can vote now. And you have approved calendar item 388. I'm going to interrupt for just a moment because we had a request for information at the beginning of this session at 2 o'clock about where we are in the number of petitions. That information has been gathered. I think it's current, and I'll ask the secretary to share this with you, and then we'll continue.
The information provided to me from the coordinator of the calendar indicates that the plenary has acted on just over 400 calendar items to date, approximately 350 of which were on consent calendars. Some items are not being scheduled by the committee on the calendar because they have financial implications and were not voted on prior to the GCFA deadline, or they are items related to human sexuality, which the Committee on Agenda and Calendar has deferred, according to the plenary action yesterday in response to the Council of Bishops report. We have 85 calendar items remaining to consider, plus 11 items that will be presented as part of the GCFA report tomorrow.
All right, thank you. Please proceed.
Thank you. The final report from Church and Society B can be found on page 2207, calendar item 390, calendar item 390, ADCA page 351, ADCA page 351, petition number 60469. Petition number 60469. The title is Healthcare in the United States for All. This petition addresses our Wesleyan commitment to care for the whole person as called for throughout Scripture. It advocates for access to healthcare for all within the United States, maintenance of the quality of care provided, effective administration of care and the costs attendant thereto, a movement toward a single-payer system, but with incremental steps and state-level initiatives that will guide our work toward that end, and coordinated advocacy efforts throughout the United Methodist agencies, boards, and commissions, again with an emphasis of those within the United States. The petition amends and updates the content of the current resolution to reflect changes in the healthcare delivery system in the United States during the last quadrennium. The committee moved to adopt 42-30. Thank you.
All right, this item is properly before us. I want to give you just a moment to indicate if you'd like to speak for or against it. I don't see anybody entering the queue, so I think you are ready. If you would get your voting devices, we'll move. Oh, sorry. Is this an inquiry? Okay, all right. You wanted to get my attention, so I give you a little time, it sounds like. Just a minute. I have a speech against now, so I'm going to move to that. Kara Nicholas? Microphone 6, please.
Yes, Kara Nicholas, Oklahoma Conference. I rise to speak against this petition. I do believe it is important for our church to speak on social issues. We as the church should provide a biblically based voice on important social issues. But what concerns me about this resolution is that we as a body pass a lot of resolutions without fully understanding and studying these resolutions and understanding the implications of what we're doing. I urge you not to vote in favor of this resolution based solely on the title or a cursory view of this resolution. Sure, we all agree and desire health care for all in the United States, but this body should hesitate to pass a resolution that takes a side on a political solution for a societal need. Two deeply committed Christians can differ on how best to address the need to provide health care for all in the United States. Perhaps you believe the government should provide health care for all and is in the best position to provide that care. And I might believe that while government has a role, the free market system is in the better solution to solve that problem. I don't believe the Bible speaks on whether the Democrats or the Republicans have the best solution for this issue, and so I suggest this body should not speak on this matter. My concern is that this resolution authorizes the general agency staff members to act as lobbyists on this issue. We spend a lot of time talking about the need for more resources, and we should not spend resources on this issue. We need to spend our resources on evangelism and new Episcopal areas and not on lobbying our U.S. Congress. Please vote no.
Thank you very much. Ready for a speech 4, Deanna Stickney Minor. Microphone 4, please.
Thank you, Bishop. My name is Deanna Stickley Minor, clergy, West Ohio, and I would urge us to support this resolution. In the United States, there are many people who live near poverty, at poverty, who struggle to provide housing, meals, health care, and other basic necessities. The General Board of Church and Society is not a lobbying organization. They are an advocacy organization, and as such, will help equip us to know how we can best advocate to provide access to quality health care for all people so that there are not some in our midst who have to file for bankruptcy because of health care bills or choose between purchasing medication and paying rent and utility bills. I believe that Jesus calls us to provide that healing spirit in our midst and provide access to health care for all people. Thank you.
Thank you. We've had a speech for and a speech against. I'm looking now for another speech against. All right, Paul Morelli, microphone 6, please.
Thank you, Bishop. Paul Morelli from Western Pennsylvania Conference, lay delegate. I agree with the speaker that spoke earlier against it. My wife worked for an organization that hired people to do work, and with the cost of the what the universal health care has put on the organization she worked for already, Their first move was to cut people from full time back below the minimum hours that required them to provide health care so that they could stay in business, and then other regulations had an effect like that too that ended up causing people to lose their jobs. And so there's a spider web effect that we may not understand. When we want to do one thing, it can affect us in a way we didn't intend to. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a number of items related to point of orders or parliamentary inquiry or information. Actually, that queue is going down, so thank you for helping me out. I'm going to call on Charlotte, is it Thorpe or Therop? Microphone 5, please, for a point of order or an inquiry.
Thank you, Bishop. Charlotte Thorpe.
Oh, yeah. Wow, I really blew that.
It's
maybe you can give me a little tutorial after this session.
Uniting Church of Sweden.
We're glad you're here.
It's a point of information.
Sure.
Am I right in assuming that this debate over this petition and many others regarding the United States would not be on the table if the UMC in the States could organize in their own central conferences?
I'm going to...
Let me step away from the mic. I don't think that... But it clearly does say...
All right. You know, I'm usually pretty good about watching for when things are going to drift into statements, and I missed that one. So we'll let it go. Thank you very much. I do have either a motion to table or postpone or refer, and I'm going to call on Jay Brim. Microphone 6, please.
Bishop Lee, Delegate Jay Brim from Rio, Texas. I rise to move to refer. If I have a second, I'll speak to it.
Is there a second? Is there a second?
Yeah. There was a second.
Yeah, okay.
Bishop, I move to refer this back to the board, General Board of Church and Society. My sister from Sweden and others of us among here are very uncomfortable with the fact that this is only about the U.S. when health concerns are global, and it would probably be helpful to the body if we had a resolution back that spoke to the whole world and not to the United States only.
All right, this is properly before us, and we have had a speech for referrals. There's someone that will speak against. Now, we're going to clear the queue because we are on a different motion. I want to be sure that I'm directing the House appropriately, and we're focusing on the correct item. So this is the motion to refer 390. And we've had a speech from the maker of the motion. I'm going to call on Andy Emanuel. Microphone 2, please. This would be a speech against referral.
Bishop, my name is Andy Emanuel, a clergy delegate from the Southern Nigeria Annual Conference. I look at this issue as something that this body needs to take a decision on it now, not to refer it. And my reason is looking at the rate of immigration in the United States and how people are coming all over the world to come to this place, healthcare is something that is very important for them to assess. So if we can look at this petition as something that can affect a lot of immigrants that are coming to the United States and take decision on it now, it will be fine. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm looking now for a speech in favor of referral. And so I'm going to go, just a moment. Yes, I'm going to go to Marilyn Bridges. Microphone 4, please.
My name is Marilyn Bridges. I'm a lay delegate from West Ohio. This is my first general conference, and I appreciate everything that's happening here. I would like to recommend voting against, or I'm sorry, for referral, because this work needs to be trimmed down. It is 2.5 pages. It needs to be a paragraph or two.
All right. I can take one more speech against referral, so I'll call on Wei Chang from microphone 6, please.
Wei Chang, clergy, New England. I speak against the referral because we cannot refer providing and standing for health care for all people. We heard from one of the speakers that we should not pay attention to the title of this petition. I think that is very opposite of it. We need to stand for this for the title's sake, because millions of people in this country still don't have health insurance or health safety net for health care, which that God has given as a gift and the basic human rights for all people. Yes, it's a US only issue, but US is a part of Global United Methodist Church too. We cannot delay standing up for what is right and just and bring healing to millions of people because it's only U.S. issues. I think it serves the Methodist Church as a whole. So I invite you to vote against the referral and stand together, at least as a people of God and follower of Jesus Christ, who offers healing to all of us, that we stood for the health care for the all people. Thank you.
Thank you. Under our rules, we need to move to vote. We've had two speeches for referral and two speeches against referral. And so the question automatically comes to us. If you would get your voting devices. If you are for referral, you'll vote yes. If you are against referral, you'll vote no. And you can vote now. All right, you have not referred item 390, so let me remind you where we are with 390. We're going to clear the queue because everything in the queue would have been related to the referral. So we've had one speech for item 390 and two against. I'm looking for a speech for, and I'll wait a moment here since I know you'll have to re-queue. All right, looks like you're ready. Katie Dawson, microphone 4. This would be a speech 4.
Hello, I'm Katie Dawson. I'm clergy from the Iowa Annual Conference. I just wanted to point our attention to the advocacy steps that are listed on page 354. If you carefully read the petition, which I hope we have, because that's our job as we prepare to come to this conference, you'll notice that although it is updated to reflect the realities of the Affordable Care Act, this petition does not speak completely in support of the Affordable Care Act. In fact, it encourages us to challenge the places where there are deficiencies, where we still do not have health care for all. And so I want to encourage us to support this work as we continue to perfect healthcare in the United States. Thank you.
All right. There has been a request to offer an amendment. I'll honor that. Opal LaSalle, microphone 3, please.
Bishop Ann LaSalle, Mississippi Annual Conference.
I move that we strike the last paragraph on page 354 and the first paragraph on page 355, and if I can get a second, I would speak to it.
Is there a second? There is. You may speak to it.
Friends, I have multiple sclerosis. Under a single-payer health system, I might be denied health coverage. I might be denied the medications that I take every day. I might be denied the 3 days of IVs that I take every month to heal my immune system because it's incredibly expensive. During the time that we were passing the Affordable Care Act, our president was on television and he actually listed my condition as a reason not to offer end-of-life life support. So if you want to guarantee that everyone in America has health coverage, you do not want a single-payer healthcare system. I was an employee of the state of Mississippi, and the state of Mississippi denied my request for coverage. I was forced to quit my job and go onto my husband's health plan in order to gain coverage. If we go to a single-payer health system, who will advocate for people like me? Who will stop the government and a single-payer health system from denying people like me health coverage? So I respectfully request that if we intend to adopt this, that we delete the language that asks us to adopt a single-payer health system. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. We have the LaSalle Amendment. There's been a speech for it from the maker of the amendment. I'm looking for speeches against it. I need to clear the queue because we're on a new item, yes. Let's make sure that we're all working with the same information. So again, I'm looking for a speech against the amendment. Give you a moment to indicate if you'd like to speak. All right, Lonnie Chafin from microphone 3, please.
Lonnie Chafin, Northern Illinois Conference. I rise to speak against the amendment because single-payer is the absolute best way to assure coverage is extended to our sister from Mississippi. Single-payer says no one gets denied from health care for having a pre-existing condition. All conditions are covered. All people are covered. There's no way, I understand her experience from the government of Mississippi, but that's because we're not in a single-payer environment. In a single-payer environment, there is health care for all persons by virtue of being a citizen of that country. Single-payer is the health care system that nearly every other country in the world uses to make sure there's coverage for all people. The way to be sure there's health coverage for our sister in Mississippi, for all of God's children, is single payer because no one can be denied coverage. And it's priced at a price they can afford, and it goes with you when you change employers, and it is suitable for your needs. So I urge you to vote against the amendment and retain the single payer language in this document because it is the best hope we have to get health insurance for all people.
Thank you. I can take a speech for or in favor of the amendment. I do not see anybody else queuing up, so I think we are ready to vote on the amendment. If you would get your voting devices. If you're in favor of the amendment, you'll vote yes. If you're opposed, you'll vote no. You can vote now. Oh, I'm sorry. Microphone 3.
Do I get to speak to the motion as the author of the motion before we vote?
I know you would like to do this, but you had your speech at the beginning.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay.
So we're in the process. I interrupted the voting, so I'm going to ask you I'll ask them to clear everything that might have been recorded in that vote. I think we're still ready to vote on the amendment. Oh, I do see someone that would like to speak for it now. Tom Wiseau. This is in order. Microphone three, please.
Yes, thank you, Bishop. Tom Wiseau, Texas Annual Conference. I'd like to speak for the amendment. Two basic reasons. One, we don't need to be embroiled in the political aspects of how health care eventually gets provided, and the single-payer issue is a political issue. Secondly, I would take issue with the speaker that says everything's covered under single-payer. Medicare is a single-payer system that we already have, and I can give you a whole list of things that have been denied that I've personally had experience with. So having said all of that, I would speak for the amendment. Thank you.
All right. I can take another speech against, and it appears we have such a speech. Rokang Chacombe, microphone two, please.
Rokang Chacombe, Northwest Katanga. Bishop, thank you. Folks, somebody stood up and said this was for only the U.S. folks. If this was only for the U.S. folks, the content of the message is what comes in the Bible about caring for the poor. All of us know that. That's one. Number two, if my sister from Mississippi and my brother who stood up for this motion knows more about Mississippi, if I get it right, the state system, and if you know more about political issue about this health care, how about brothers outside of America if they don't know anything but you're asking them to vote for something? Folks, please, let's vote this amendment down and go to the motion. Think about the poor. And the question you may ask yourself, who is poor? Maybe your neighbors is poor. Maybe me, your neighbors from Congo, is poor. Please, please, let's be real. Forget about the politics out. See the Bible. Thank you.
All right. We've had two speeches for and two speeches against the amendment. I'm going to have the amendment reread by our secretary so that you understand where we're at, and then we'll move immediately to vote. So have your voting devices handy. Just don't, we won't put it up on the screen until we read the amendment so you're clear.
Remove last paragraph on page 354 and first paragraph on page 355. Remove single payer language.
All right. We're ready to vote. If you would vote in favor of the amendment, would you please press one, and if you're against, press two, press no, or number two, excuse me. You have defeated the amendment. So we're back to the main motion, item 390. And let me tell you where we're at. We're kind of an interesting place because we've already had the two speeches for and two against, and it has not been amended. And so we are ready to vote on it. I'm going to give the chair an opportunity to speak, and then we'll proceed to vote.
Thank you, Bishop. Yesterday, we saw a powerful presentation called Imagining Abundant Health. Abundant health includes the ability to access healthcare services, but also to be able to afford those services without overwhelming burden. This resolution represents the epitome of the Good Samaritan. May we align ourselves with this pericope and support the Legislative Committee's recommendation to adopt.
All right, it's before us. If you would get your voting devices handy. If you are in favor of 390, you'll vote yes, number one, no, number two. You can vote now. and you have supported item 390. So, thank folks, you, I just want to tell you where we're at. We have about 10 minutes or so before an order of the day, a very brief order of the day, prior to closing this session. And I think we have time perhaps for another item, maybe two. And we'll move to that at this point. There is, however, a point of, we're going to, I just want to check there, a point of order just came up. I'll take that point of order, parliamentary inquiry or information, microphone three, please. Amiral Idem, item.
Thank you, Bishop. A question.
Yes.
Of these 85 pieces of legislation that we will be looking over the next day and a half, are they prioritized to where we can attend to disciplinary pieces before we tend to resolutions?
I'll need to turn to Secretary.
The report I have from the coordinator of the calendar is that it's generally sorted that way, but there are exceptions. It's not a pure sort because of the work and the sometimes distracted way we get things through.
Bishop, would it be in order for me to make a motion that it may be that away?
Well, I think what would be more appropriate is if I cleared the queue and you re-entered if you wanted to make a motion. That would allow us to begin to proceed. Thank you very much. We'll move to our next item of business.
I'm Jim Aches from Indiana, and I was privileged to be the chair of the local church committee, and we met and did our work, and we finally got to the floor. We hadn't gotten to the floor yet. And I want to give thanks to those that helped me as we did it. My vice chair for our group was Abraham Arpalay. Sarah Johnson was our secretary. We had two sub-chairs, Isaac Chuck Poo Padmore, and another subcommittee chair was Dixie Brewster. We bring two, but I'm going to only reintroduce one right now. The one we introduce now is found on page DCA 2215, catalog number 454. It's petition number 60614, found in the ADCA at 1038. I brought Dixie with me, who was the sub-chair that handled that, and she will bring the rest of the petition before you.
Bishop, I'm Dixie Brewster from the Great Plains Conference, Lay, and we had an awesome subcommittee, and we are looking to present this on supplemental ministries, and the petition encourages supplemental ministry programs for women and men in addition to United Methodist Women and United Methodist Men. And it has been brought to our attention that there is a minority report, and so I believe we may need to listen to that first.
Yes. Our minority reports are treated as amendments, and so we will receive that and then determine if we want to, or we will deal with it. It cannot be amended.
Microphone five.
Microphone, is this the minority report?
Six.
Microphone
six.
Microphone six, please. Yes, thank you.
Thank you. I'm Karen Mann, delegate and lay leader from the Arkansas Conference. Throughout this conference, we have been hearing about the need to do things differently, to expand our outreach, and to better serve the needs of our communities. this petition presents an opportunity to add this sort of encouragement to paragraph 256, which deals with the program ministries of the local church. The original petition focused on men's and women's ministries, but I ask that we encourage our congregations to think outside the box with respect to ministries for children and youth as well, and to consider church school, small groups, and scouting ministries, as opposed to only focusing on women's and men's ministries. In reality, these programs would be supplemental to the program life of the local church and not merely supplemental to the work of United Methodist Women or United Methodist Men. There's currently no barrier to forming supplemental ministries, but if this sort of encouragement is needed, the minority report would extend this encouragement to the entire church. The minority report, as printed on page 2215, ends the petition after the word program. This provides clarity where actually less is better. It refrains from defining supplemental ministry as only a being for women or for men. I ask that you support the minority report so that we can provide and encourage supplemental ministries for all persons and the entire church. Thank you.
Thank you. The minority report is before us, and that is a speech for. I'm going to clear the queue because we're now on another item, and I'm not sure just when these items came in, if they might have been for the original motion. I do want to acknowledge that there are two or three items in the queue looking at suspending the rules or a new item. It might be related to the inquiry earlier about where we are in our process. We'd certainly want to get to that at some point if the House wants to govern itself and how it proceeds with the remaining time we have today and tomorrow. But currently we're on the minority report, which is being treated like an amendment. We've had one speech for. Is there anyone that would care to speak against it? All right, I'm going to call on another speech for Yvette Richards. Microphone 6, please.
Thank you, Bishop. Yvette Richards, Missouri Conference. I appreciate the minority report emphasizes on clarity. The original language could also be interpreted to mean that all supplemental ministries are not only supplement to United Methodist Women and United Methodist Men, but in a reporting relationship to those organizations. Said another way, the UMW-UMM would oversee any ministries related to women and men respectively. Thank you, Bishop.
All right. I'm looking for a speech against the minority report. I do not see any coming into the queue, and we've had the requisite number of speeches for, so I think you're probably ready to move on this. Because a minority report comes out of committee, committee chair does have an opportunity to speak.
I would like to encourage you to oppose the minority report because in this, our supplemental ministries does truly expand our ability to witness to others. It is an additional number, and many of the ministries, if you'll look in your book of discipline along the lines of this paragraph, many different items are listed. This would just be an additional number, and there are many cases in local churches that pastors do not encourage ministries outside of your United Methodist Women or United Methodist Men. I am a United Methodist Women president, and I love that ministry. And I know that there are clergy who only support United Methodist Women and Men's Ministries when there are awesome supplemental ministries out there that our young adults can go with and be witnesses for. My daughter, for instance, isn't that much in favor of our United Methodist Women's Group because of some of the structure. However, their young women's ministry is very vital, and our pastor is very much in favor of. So this is not to speak against our United Methodist Women or United Methodist Men. It is to allow an avenue to further our witness for Christ, to be transforming, and to allow our churches to be very vital and have the ability to share the passions that we have to be in ministry to women and children in need in addition to our other ministries that are approved.
Thank you. So we're on the minority report, and I think we're ready to vote. If you would get your voting devices in hand. If you would support the, let me just tell you where we're at before we vote. I just want to be very clear. If you support the minority report, it becomes the main motion. If you oppose the minority report, we are back to the main motion. So if you would vote yes in favor, if you would vote yes in favor of the minority report, number one. If you're against the minority report, number two, you may vote now. You have opposed the minority report, and so we're back to the main motion for 70. And once again, I'm going to clear the queue. Merle, you're really persistent out there. Merle, I think I know what you want to do, so please enter once again. I'm sorry to bump you, but it's the only way we can do this. If you'd clear the queue. We're going to get to you, Merle. All right, we're back on 470, and we have a speech against Donna. Is it Bogie Trust or Trust? Yeah, I believe. A microphone one, please.
Good afternoon, Bishop Michelle Bogue Trust.
Okay.
And now the entire General Conference knows the name I do not use.
Yes. Yes. Well, that's the name I've got.
Yep. Michelle Bogue Trust, Upper New York Annual Conference clergy. Unless I've heard our church messaging wrong and our bishops wrong, I believe that we are always encouraged to develop new ministries, supplemental to those listed in the Book of Discipline. I've also heard many times on this floor, here and in previous quadrennia, that we keep adding stuff to the book. We spend too much time on the floor discussing things, we add too many things to the book. I fail to see why we need to add this to the Book of Discipline.
All right. Friends, I probably should not have started that. We are up against an order of the day and our break time, so we're going to put a pin in this, and when we reconvene after the break, we'll pick this up, and the new presiding officer will be aware we're on 470 that we've had one speech against. I do want to call on Merle. Microphone three, please. Merle Idem. Microphone three, I think, our item.
Thank you, Bishop.
Pronounce your name so I get it right next time.
Part of my motion is that y'all call me Matt Item and not Merle. They call Daddy Merle.
Okay, well, all right, go ahead.
I move that we prioritize the remaining of this general conference to attend first to legislation that addresses the Book of Discipline with resolutions to follow. If I can get a second, I don't think I need to speak to that.
Is there a second? All right, it's a new item. I entertained it just because I want to be sure the body can direct how it wants to do its work. We've where we are as we have this new item. Is there anyone that would speak for or against it? Let me clear the queue because I'm not sure what the queue is about any longer. Okay, if you would speak for or against this item, would you please queue in? All right, I'm going to call on David Bard, point of order. Microphone 5, please.
Good afternoon, Bishop. David Bard, Minnesota Conference. It's not a point of order, but a point of information. Would the General Secretary be able to tell us what this might require from his office if we passed it?
Go ahead. Yes.
The information that I have at this stage is that there are 54 disciplinary, 25 resolutions, and 4 non-disciplinary items that need to be addressed, and it would require not my office, but the Committee on Calendar, Agenda and Calendar, to work through the sequencing of that.
Thank you.
All right. Sarah Swenson, microphone 5. I believe this may be a motion to table or postpone or refer. Go ahead,
Sarah Swenson, lead delegate from Minnesota. This is a move to refer the motion to the calendar, the Committee on Calendar and Agenda. I know that it's a very representative group and includes the chairs of many of the committees, and I'm sure that they would take this under advisement, and our friend Merle could also join them at their 6:30 meeting to help further guide that. Thank you.
I think he wants to go by Matt. All right. So a motion to refer this matter back to agenda and calendaring. Anyone care to speak against that? Anyone else want to speak for it? Okay, I'm not sure yep. It looks like you're policing yourselves very well to clear the queue. Let's clear the queue because we're on the referral. We had a motion to refer this matter. I don't see anybody else queuing up. Thank you very much. You're doing a great job. All right, I think we're ready. If you would vote to refer this matter to calendar and agenda, would you please take your devices and vote number 1 for referral, number 2 no, against referral. All right, you have referred this matter. Friends, we are past our order of the day, so I'm going to move to that. And then I have just a couple of closing remarks before you leave. Thank you for your attention. We're moving to a recognition of Neil Alexander.
Thank you, Bishop. I'm Carl Frazier. I'm a clergy member of the North Carolina Annual Conference, and I am the chair of the Board of Directors of the United Methodist Publishing House. At the 1996 General Conference, the United Methodist Church was formally introduced to its new president and publisher. Neil Alexander came to this role after serving the church in children's-related services, Urban Ministries, the then General Board of Discipleship, and as editor-in-chief of Abingdon Press. He served the church well in all of these capacities over these years. For the past 20 years, the church has been blessed to have Neil's steady hand at the helm of the publishing house. He has guided us through a sea change in the publishing industry, from print to e-books, from Sunday school periodicals to video and digital curriculum, from brick and mortar stores to an online presence. The rapidity of change in the industry and in the church has required dexterity, vision, and a business acumen wed to a deep and abiding love for the church and its people. And all of these have characterized Neil Alexander's stewardship of the book concern of the United Methodist Church. As Neil enters into retirement, he will conclude the longest tenure as president and publisher since the two roles were combined into one in 1956. And it is my honor on behalf of the United Methodist Publishing House Board of Directors to invite this general conference to express its deep appreciation and gratitude to Neil for his devotion to and service to our church. Many of you know Neil, and I've been privileged to be a close colleague and friend for many years, and we truly have been blessed by his ministry, and I expect we'll continue to be blessed by his ministry. We have an announcement, I believe.
This is a request from the Korean Peace Ministry. Please return the crosses that some of you have taken from the tables, and there should be two on each table to be available as part of their celebration. Thank you.
I also want to share with you a prayer request that came to us during this session. Bob Berglund, who's a clergy delegate from the North Carolina Conference, went to the hospital from our morning plenary with chest pressure and pain and is currently in cardiac ICU for evaluation. So we'll want to remember Bob in our prayers. And I want to thank this body for your able work this afternoon and for the discipline you're showing and trying to show as you trying to guide the work here in these hours that remain. I appreciate all of your efforts. I want to personally take a moment and apologize to Michael Childs. I was heavy-handed with Michael. I think my impatience was, which those who know me most intimately know is still one of those parts of my life to be transformed. And I did not intend to disrespect him or you as a body, but to try to help you move along. Thanks to Bishop Hope Morgan Ward and Bishop Brown for backing me up. As you can see, I needed it, and I'm very appreciative. Will you pray with me? Lord God, we are grateful for your presence among us, because without that presence, we'd be a mess. And so we pray that we might continue to lean heavily into your love and grace and open ourselves ever more fully to your leading. Be with us now as we move into this brief break, that we might take a deep breath. And even as we breathe in, we pray that your spirit will be breathed out upon Bob Berglund. Surround him with those who are offering your healing care and healing touch, that he might know that you are accompanying him in each moment as he moves toward recovery. We pray all of this in the name and the spirit of the one who came among us to offer us life, to save us, the Christ. Amen.